धीरेन सर सर इनके यहाँ पे वो नहीं चल रहा, तो वी कैन रिकॉर्ड देन अपलोड कर दें 10:30 को वी विल लाइक We can start.
Good evening. On behalf of Ahmedabad Family Physician Association, I, Dr. Dhirendra Sanandia, welcomes all the viewers. Today on Zoom meeting, I have with me an eminent speaker, Dr. Jay Kumar Mehta from Zydus Hospital, Ahmedabad. He is going to talk on topic and approach to COPD patient. COPD is a rising concern in the respiratory medicine, and family physician fraternity has a big role to play to mitigate these challenges posed by COPD. Before starting the talk, I will give brief introduction of our speaker, Dr. Jay Kumar Mehta. He is amongst the first pulmonologists from the Gujarat to undergo the post-MD modular training, a fellowship program in the specialty of pulmonology from prestigious Christian Medical College, Vellore. He was awarded as best emerging consultant. He has specialized training in bronchoscopy and medical thoracoscopy with competence in diagnosis and managing various respiratory disorders like allergic rhinitis, asthma, COPD, airway disorder, pneumonia, tuberculosis, pulmonary fibrosis, lung cancer, hydropneumothorax, pulmonary thromboembolism, and vasculitis. He carries vast experience of interventional pulmonary procedures like tracheobronchial stenting, balloon bronchoplasty, lung cryobiopsy, bronchoscopic deobstruction, as well as deloculation, and adenolysis in the pleural space with medial thoracoscopy. At present, he is providing his service as a full-time consultant and interventional pulmonologist at Zydus Hospital, Ahmedabad. Now I request Dr. Jay Kumar Mehta to start his talk. Dr. Jay Kumar Mehta, please. Sir, mute yourself.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction, Dr. Dhirendra Bhai. Now I would like to begin my presentation, but before that, can you just confirm that am I audible? Am I loud and clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. You are perfectly audible.
Thank you so much. So, today I will be speaking on an approach to COPD patients. Being a family physician, we come across so many cases where we suspect that this patient might have COPD. But how to confirm and to proceed with selection of bronchodilator or inhaler medications? So the learning objectives from this PowerPoint presentation is, first, to identify the patients with COPD from other chest symptomatics. What are these patients who have COPD have different from other chest symptomatics, like the persons or patients who have cough, phlegm or sputum production, and breathlessness? And second and most important part is, how do we assess the COPD patients to address the treatment goals? So this comes to a very vital question, that what is the treatment goal of a COPD patient? Some might say that it can be reduction in the symptom, relief of breathlessness, but actually according to the GOLD guidelines, GOLD, which is a universally accepted literature for COPD, it defines treatment goals for stable COPD as relief of symptoms, improve exercise tolerance, and improvement in health status, which is considered as a reduction in the symptoms. And the treatment which we are providing also should halt the disease progression. It should prevent and treat exacerbations. And finally, ultimately, it should reduce the risk. Hence, we can divide the treatment goals into two parts, reduction in the symptoms and reduction in the risk. But before we go towards it, let us have a brief understanding of COPD. Let us brush our knowledge after so many years of what actually is COPD and what it stands in 2021. Again, stating the basic literature of Global Initiative for Chronic Obstructive Lung Diseases. This is GOLD, which provides us scientific literature on how to diagnose, treat and manage COPD. According to GOLD, COPD is defined as common, preventable and treatable disease. Now, those who are pretty interested in COPD, they might have recollected that there is one more word, there was one more word here, where they added it is usually progressive. As per my knowledge, they dropped this word, usually progressive, somewhere between 2017-2018. Because of the evidences and scientific basis coming up, there are few patients where the COPD remains static and it is not progressive. Hence, the COPD is defined as common, preventable and treatable disease, which is characterized by persistent respiratory symptoms. This is very important aspect of the patient having COPD. The patient has persistent of the respiratory symptoms. There are no episodes of disease-free interval. And airflow limitation, what it is, we will learn more in detail in coming slides, which happens due to airway and or alveolar abnormalities, which is usually caused by significant exposure to noxious particles or gases. Again, we will learn this in upcoming slides. It is influenced by the host factors, including abnormal lung development, and significant comorbidities may have an impact on morbidity and mortality. In short, this is what the COPD is. This is what the description of COPD is. This is what the definition of COPD is. Now let us delve some more in detail about COPD. What is the etiology, pathobiology, and pathology of COPD, which leads to airflow limitation and the clinical manifestations. So this is a flow chart. There are some etiological factors like smoking, pollutants. It's basically gene environment or host environment interplay, which leads to pathobiology of lung injury and inflammation in the lungs as well as in overall body, that is systemic inflammation, which leads to small airway disorders or abnormalities, emphysema and systemic effects, which finally leads to clinical manifestations of symptoms, exacerbations and comorbidities and airflow limitation. So when the term COPD comes to our ears, two predominant processes, which is usually a traditional teaching. First, it is an obstructive chronic bronchitis, which is defined as production of cough and sputum production on almost all the days of the year for consecutive 2 years. Now, this is one of very important symptom, which I think we ignore to ask in detail. Like we routinely see patients of diarrhea, but I don't recollect any patient who has bronchorrhea, which is more than 100 ml of sputum production in a day. We see it very rarely, right? And because of that, we don't document the COPD patient's basic symptom frequency. Obviously, there are some objective parameters to assess severity of cough and sputum production, but none of them have taken place in usual care of COPD patients. Based on that, we cannot decide our treatment. But cough and sputum production has definitely taken place when it comes to COPD exacerbations. modified Anthonyson's criteria, which defines acute exacerbation of COPD, has involved two cardinal symptoms, that is increase in the sputum production and development of sputum purulence, to decide further course to treat acute exacerbation of COPD. But anyways, I request from the platform of Ahmedabad Family Physician Association that whenever such patient comes to you, you have to always document that what are the baseline symptom or baseline cough status. So whether the patient is having coughing in the early morning hours, whether the patient produces phlegm which fills the cup, half cup, or it is scanty, what are the color, whether it is whitish, it is thick or thin, yellowish or reddish in color. In my experience, four things which are very important and cardinal in history taking of a COPD patient is: first, cough disturbing sleep; second, cough disturbing professional activities, like in a meeting, if the patient has to cough, it means that cough is a significant symptom; third, amount of sputum produced in a day; and fourth, is there any blood coming in the sputum or not. This four symptom, this four cardinal symptom related to or inquiries in the symptom of cough helps me to identify the patient is having acute exacerbation or not. And obviously the second thing is emphysema, which comes in our mind. Yes, what is emphysema? Emphysema literally means voluminous lungs. As the classical description of Sir René Laennec, it has described that the patients who smoke for long term, they have voluminous lungs. So we will just visit the structure function pathology in the next slide. But ultimately what happens is that there is destruction of the alveolar parenchyma. There are small airway dysfunction, small airway obstruction. And because of that, there is a pathology going on which is considered as air trapping, which leads to hyperinflation in a long term, which contributes into the overall symptomatology of the patients of persistent airflow limitation. Now let us understand what actually is persistent airflow limitation with this graph. This is a schematic diagram which shows that this is a small airway and this is the alveoli, and these are the collagen fibers which are holding the airway open. In cases of COPD, particularly in emphysema, these attachments get loosened. They become very much fragile. And because of that, the alveoli, they lose their complete integrity. And because of that, air cannot be emptied. There is airflow limitation, which is appropriately termed as expiratory airflow limitation. This is the flow volume loop on the spirometry, which we routinely perform to diagnose COPD patients. Well, this is the scalloped expiratory loop, which we look when the patient is suffering from airflow limitation. What happens when the airflow limitation goes on for the long time? These patients develop increase in the residual volume. It is always told that these patients always have tendency to breathe at high functional residual capacity. So this is a normal person. As you can see, this is the diaphragm and these are the lungs. And what we can see is expiratory lung volumes. And these are the expiratory lung volumes at the end of exercise. While in COPD patient, as you can see, the diaphragm are flattened, or it has resulted in the barrel-shaped chest. And because of that, expiratory lung volumes are more, which results in easy fatigue. Diaphragm is the chief inspiratory muscle. Once it becomes flattened, once the intercostal muscles become weakened, the process of breathing, which is also considered as a pump, it gets hampered and the patient develops effort intolerance. So this is the basic pathology which happens in the patients of COPD. Now coming to the risk factors. This is very important information we should obtain from each and every COPD patient. As most of us know that cigarette smoking is one of the most important culprit to develop COPD. It is one of the most well-studied risk factor, but not all smokers develop COPD. Fewer than 50% smokers develop COPD. So how shall we know that this smoker will develop COPD and this smoker will not? Well, smoking has direct dose response relationship with the lung pathologies. And hence it is essential to quantify the smoking exposure, not even at the diagnosis, but every time during the follow-up visits too. Whether the patient is current smoker or ex-smoker, how many packs a person smokes cigarette in 1 year, it is termed as pack years. And usually the smoking is quantified in the pack years. So let's say if a person smokes one pack of cigarette a day for 20 years, then the person has exposure of 20 pack years. Remember, the person who has smoked less than 100 cigarettes in a lifetime is considered as never smoker. So this important aspect of history is essential to diagnose COPD. Coming to another part, that is age and gender. As age advances, particularly COPD sets in after age of 40 years, and it happens more and more, it happens, it encounters more frequently when the patient crosses age of 60. Usually the male gender, male people are at high risk of development of COPD. Yes, lung growth and development. This is one of the most ignored part in historical aspect of a COPD patient. Abnormal lung growth and development has now been considered as one of the significant risk factors to develop COPD in a lifetime. So low birth weight, birth history of a patient is very important. Low birth weight, whether the patient required incubator at the time or the postnatal stay, whether the patient had childhood respiratory infections, whether the patient was malnourished, and if there is any accelerated loss of FEV1 or not, it is very important and essential aspects in the historical part. Now, I would like to stress on what is accelerated loss of FEV1. Usually, after the age of 25 years, as the lung growth, as the lung ages, there is certain physiological loss of FEV1. If the person loses this FEV1 more rapidly, then it is termed as accelerated loss of FEV1. And for that, it is very essential that each and every individual, mainly after age of 40 years, mainly those persons who are smoking actively, should undergo pulmonary function testing or spirometry as a routine part of their health checkup assessment. This is very important to document that every year, patient should maintain the same FEV1 or at least have a physiological loss of FEV1. Coming to other infections which contribute to development of COPD. In India, tuberculosis is very common, and post-tuberculosis obstructive arthritis also behave like COPD. Likewise, Pseudomonas aeruginosa infections have also been studied as a risk factor for development of COPD. A patient who is having asthma since childhood or from the young adolescence can develop fixed airway obstruction if the asthma is not well managed, and it is also a risk factor for development of COPD. And I think probably that's why term asthma COPD overlap came in existence. Again, genetic factors like alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, well, it is considered very small part of the patients develop COPD, but still it is a risk factor. Now coming to the environmental part, where the indoor and outdoor air pollution plays significant role. Now the aim of this country is to become a $5 trillion economy, and for that it requires industrial growth. And because of that, increase in urbanization, increase in industrialization, there will be somewhat damage in air quality, which is going to happen. How much it has happened, we'll just see in the next slide. But role of EQI, that is air quality index trackers, is paramount, particularly the patients who are suffering from COPD, to prevent the flare-ups and exacerbation. So a person who is living in a bad air quality index environment, when the person is exposed to a lot of biomass fuel, like cow dung, like wood, like crop residues, which are used as a fuel in all the villages, when the person have exposed to that part, that indoor and outdoor air pollution, they are also considered very significant risk factors to develop COPD. Again, poverty, because of poverty there is lack of ventilation, and lower socioeconomic class, again leading to the same poor air quality in indoor environments, can lead to COPD. Finally, occupational exposure. Well, the patient is living in a good neighborhood, but if the person is engaged in a work of furnaces, in mining, in milling, like many people are green merchants, they are involved in the millet productions. So in that particular occupation, there is also risk of exposure of the particles, as it can be seen that it is up to 31% in the non-smokers where they develop COPD. So this all demographical parameters are very important, which we usually ignore in the patients who are coming to us to seek the consultation. This is very important piece of information for all the COPD patients to get diagnosed rapidly. Now, let's go towards the burden of COPD in India. Well, I'm not going into the epidemiological aspect in detail, but just look at this graph. This is from the Lancet Global. As you can see, the pinkish or reddish area, they depict high prevalence of COPD. As you can see, in 1990, we hardly see any red part. While in 2016, almost North India, either it is pinkish or reddish. It means the people who stay in North India, Rajasthan, Haryana, Uttar Pradesh, they are more prone to develop COPD. So the place of residence, as I told in the previous slide, it is very important. There is one more factor which is very important in these patients. Ahmedabad being a renowned state for the financial activities, there are many people from outside states who come here, and in season from September to March, they go to their native place like Delhi. And during that travel, because of poor air quality at that point of time, usually these patients get easy exacerbations. So this is very important aspect, that if you want your patients to stay healthy, to prevent flare-ups, you need to educate them about all of this parameter, about air quality index, about the risk factors, and how to prevent exposure. And then their COPD can remain stable. So in nutshell, what are the must not miss points in history taking of a just symptomatic patient, which can indicate the patient is having COPD? That is age and gender, age more than 40 years and male gender, smoking status, whether it is current or past smoking status, particularly of more than 20 pack years, occupation, whether they are involved in the particulate dust, gases or fumes, residence, birth history, history of previous respiratory infections, including tuberculosis. Yes, comorbidities. This is very important aspect of COPD assessment. There are many patients who are having, who have a simple compounding risk factor like smoking, and they also develop cardiovascular diseases. They also develop peripheral vascular diseases. They also develop lung cancer. They're also prone to get tuberculosis. They're also prone to get bronchitis. So this is very important that comorbidities should be assessed in each and every individual patients. And what are the current medications? Like if the patient is taking non-selective beta blocker, then your bronchodilators might not help you. So this is very important that what medications the patient is taking. And you should always ask for family history of obstructive airway diseases, because patient might have asthma, COPD, overlap. Now coming to the key indicators for considering a diagnosis of COPD, whether the person or the patient who is walking in your cabin, who the chest symptomatic is that patient can be having COPD. So yes, as we have discussed earlier, there are history of risk factors, there is history of recurrent lower respiratory tract infection, and three cardinal symptoms, that is breathlessness, which is gradual onset progressive, chronic cough with no episodic disappearance, and chronic sputum production. These three symptoms can definitely suggest, keeping this background of risk factors in mind, that this patient may have COPD. Coming to physical examination of a patient. So when we ask that the patient is having breathlessness, we need to quantify that how much the patient is breathless. Like I told about the cough, but the breathlessness is very distressing symptom to the patient at it. And mostly that is the symptom why patient has seek your consultation. So we need to objectively classify it and grade it according to modified MRC dyspnea scale. So there is no need to remember all the five categories, but we just need to remember this grade two, that is the pace, the speed with which the patient walks or does the activity, and on the level ground has become slower, or the patient has to stop to catch the breath on walking at the own pace. This is very important. Usually the patient says that when I used to go walk, initially I used to walk this much in this minutes, now I'm not able to walk this. So this is very important classification, because a patient is having more breathlessness or less breathlessness is the chief criteria based on which we are going to give inhaled or oral bronchodilator treatment. Subjectively, we can also ask patient to fill this COPD assessment test. Usually it's time consuming, and most often it takes time also. So, but still, for theoretical interest, if the patient has score more than 10, then it is considered that patient is having more breathlessness. If the score is 9 or less, then it is considered the patient has less breathlessness. So coming to the physical examination, you just have to look at the torso of the patient who is sitting in front of you. And if you will see at this clinical signs, you can definitely make out that the patient is having COPD. So usually an elderly guy, which is cachectic, which is lean and thin, who is having mostly breathing, central cyanosis and prolonged expiration. Sometimes they have reduced in the cricosternal distance. They are using accessory muscles of expirations. There is intercostal undrumming during the inspiration. Also, the patient stabilizes the ribcage by keeping both the hands over the edge of the seat. And there is development of a barrel-shaped chest. On percussion, there is loss of cardiac dullness. You can, on auscultation, you can hear that there is almost reduced breath sounds. There is presence of wheezing, bibasal crepitations, and you can hear the heart sounds in the epigastrium. This all suggests that the patient has COPD. Important two, three things which we usually see in general examination. First is external lymphadenopathy or the neck lymphadenopathy. Because if it is there, then it may indicate the patient might have lung cancer or tuberculosis. Second, elevated jugular venous pressure, which indicate development of core pulmonal or right heart failure. Third, development of bilateral leg swellings may also indicate the same thing, that the heart has been short. And fourth and very important thing is presence of clubbing. Usually COPD patients don't develop clubbing, but because of the compounding effect, again, if there is presence of clubbing, then the patient might have either bronchiectasis or lung cancer. This is very important aspect in the general examination which you should look for. So coming to the differential diagnosis, what else can this patient have? According to me, the first common differential diagnosis is bronchiectasis. Because bronchiectasis patient behaves in similar way. Asthma patients are easy to sort, because they have symptom-free or disease-free intervals, while bronchiectasis patients don't have any disease-free interval. And in our country, tuberculosis is very common. And each and every patient who has more than 2 weeks of cough may have tuberculosis. So definitely TB, asthma, and bronchiectasis are the first three differentials which I'll put. which has to be ruled out with the subsequent investigations. Again, lung cancer, as I told you, the typical signs of a lung cancer, that this patient might be harboring a mass in the lung. Fourth is left heart failure. Interstitial lung diseases are due to advent of HR city thorax are now becoming very common. Initially, in pre-COVID era, CT scan was not that commonly done for the chest symptomatics. But post-COVID, people are now used to get the CT scan done easily. And because of that, now we are picking lots and lots of interstitial lung disease patients too. And finally, cystic fibrosis, which we see less often. So pathways to diagnose of COPD is symptoms, risk factors, and spirometry. Without spirometry, you cannot diagnose the patient is having COPD. And by spirometry, I mean this. This is the pneumotachograph or pneumotachometer. It is also a form of spirometry, which is very accurate. Usually we have a small portable, which is considered as portable or screening type of spirometer. That is also important if you have in your cabin. You just have to tell the patient to blow as fast and as long as possible, and it will give us very important piece of information in form of FEV1 FVC and FEV1 FVC ratio. Now this is not a class on spirometry, so I'll not go into detail. But first and foremost, what you have to look at is FEV1 FVC ratio. Gold suggests that if it is less than 0.7, it is the pakka sign that the patient has airflow limitation. Once it is determined that it is less than 0.7, you have to see the FEV1 predicted, percent predicted, and you have to grade accordingly. So this is the normal curve. As you can see, the FEV1 FVC ratio is more than 0.7. And this is the obstructive curve where the FEV1 FVC ratio is less than 0.7. How to classify the severity? So classification of airflow limitation is based on post bronchodilator FEV1. Most of the spirometry which is done in the family clinics, I saw it's only done pre bronchodilator. Either you have to give 400 micrograms of a short-acting beta 2 agonist or 160 micrograms of short-acting anticholinergic agent and repeat spirometry after 15 to 20 minutes of duration. And then you document this spirometry variables, FEV1, FVC, and FEV1 FVC ratio. And based on that, yes, it is the post-bronchodilator spirometry which diagnoses the patient with COPD. In patients with FEV1 FVC ratio less than 0.7, if the FEV1 is more than or equal to 80%, it means it is mild. If it is between 50 to 80%, it is moderate or gold 2. If it is between 30 to 50%, then it is severe or gold 3. And if it is less than 30%, it means it is gold 4 or very severe. Likewise, you need to demonstrate the severity of airflow limitation. What are the other investigations? Let's say we do CBC. In CBC, what we can see? Polycythemia and leukocytosis. In X-ray chest PAVO, we can see emphysematous chest. ECG, we do routinely. There are P-pulmonal if the patient has COPD. 2D echocardiography to document pulmonary hypertension. 6-minute walk test is very important test because 6-minute walk distance and exertional desaturation carries very important prognostic value. I'll just tell at the end of the this PowerPoint presentation. BMI again is carrying very high prognostic value in patients with COPD, and comorbidities assessment like creatinine, SGPT, and other like blood sugar test and everything you should do as per the patient's requirement. Yes, there are still few more questions to be asked to the patients with COPD, and that needs somewhat introspection too. So this is related to the exacerbations of COPD, which is defined as acute worsening of respiratory symptoms, which results in additional therapy. So basically, it is an event-based classification of exacerbation. You have to remember that it is based on how we treat the patient. So if the patient has been treated with only short-acting bronchodilators, then it is mild. If we have given antibiotics as well as oral steroids in addition to short-acting bronchodilators, then this is moderate. And if the patient has required hospitalization, then it is severe. Hence, we should be very much cautious in prescribing medications, in writing antibiotics, in writing oral steroids, in admitting the patients, because in the past records, where we see the past records, it is considered as significant exacerbations. And once it is significant exacerbation, it increases the treatment group, it changes the patient's group. So once we have done this information, once we have got this information, we have full approach to the COPD patient. And this approach means assessment of the symptoms, which is based on MMRC grade, CAT score, and detailed history taking. Assessment of severity based on spirometry, walk test, echocardiography, and radiology. And assessment of exacerbation risk by reviewing the past treatment records. And that gives us to a refined ABCD assessment tool. Once we have diagnosed the COPD on basis of spirometry, once we have assessed the severity of the airflow limitation, then we classify the patient, whether the patient is having less breathlessness or more breathlessness based on the symptom like MMRC 0 and 1, which I told you in previously. And if the MMRC scale is 2 or more, then the patient is more breathless, groups B and D. And if there is no exacerbation which or hospitalization, or there is one or more hospitalization, then according to that, we need to classify the patient into group AB or CD. And the treatment is based on the group of the patient in which the patient belongs. So if the patient is in group A, usually these patients are not the just symptomatic patients. Usually we see them as preoperative pulmonary assessment patients. Usually these patients are the patients who have come for the health checkup. And then we finally find out that this patient is also having COPD. The patient who is having group B, who are in group B, has to be treated with long-acting bronchodilator. The patient in group C, the preferred choice of agent is long-acting antimuscarinic agent. And the patient in group B, either they can be treated with LABA, LAMA, or ICS, or triple therapy. So based on the refined ABCD assessment tool, we need to classify each COPD patient, and the treatment, initial pharmacological treatment, depends on that. So sometimes we see the patient has been given theophylline, the patient has been given short-acting bronchodilators, sometimes long-acting bronchodilators, but this is the basis on which you should take scientific decisions to reduce the risk and reduce the symptoms, which is the goal for treatment of stable COPD patients. Finally, two more slides. Obviously, the COPD is not a curable disease. So patient or patient's relative will ask about the prognostic or prognostic markers. And there the role of BOD index comes, which stands for body mass index, airflow obstruction, dyspnea, and exercise capacity index. So if the BOD index point is 7 to 10, it means the 4-year survival is only 18%. 82% of patients will not be living after 4 years. And you can just prognosticate accordingly and after the treatment responses. And finally, when the patient needs hospitalization. So if the symptoms are very severe, like the patient is breathless, having breathlessness at rest, patient has low saturation level, patient is having drowsiness, patient is confused, having signs of acute respiratory failure, or you have already given treatment with antibiotics, oral steroids, increased frequency of a bronchodilator, still patient is not responding, or there is lack of social support, then you need to admit this patient. So take home messages: as you diagnose BP with the help of sigmomanometer, you diagnose diabetes with the help of blood glucose. Likewise, COPD is diagnosed based on spirometry. And once you diagnose it, you need to go into refined COPD ABCD assessment tool, and you need to classify the patient according and designate a group to the patient. It has to be written in all COPD patients that it is GOLD 2, group B. And like that, you treat the patients accordingly. So thank you so much for your patient listening. With this, I conclude my presentation. Now, if there are any questions or answers, I'll be happy to take.
Yes, sir. One question is, what is more reliable for the study, for a study on pulmonary function test, the FEVC, FEV1, PEFR values or their percentage of predicted? What does the difference difference signify?
Just a minute, let me be clear with the question first, sir. So this question is on spirometry, right? This question is on spirometry, that what is important, whether FEV1, FVC, FEV1, FVC, PEFR, or is there anything else?
Percentage of predicted.
So as far as to diagnose COPD patient, most important criteria is FEV1 FVC ratio, which has to be which is obtained after giving post bronchodilator test, as I mentioned during the lecture, that pre bronchodilator test carries very less significance. To diagnose COPD, we need to do a post-bronchodilator test. And FEV1 FVC ratio is of paramount importance. Based on that, we keep the diagnosis of COPD. And after doing this diagnosis, we just monitor the FEV1. Our treatment aim is to increase the FEV1. In fact, almost all the studies which have been done so far has targeted the annual FEV1 increase or propensity to halt the FEV1 decline. And hence, FEV1 is paramount marker after starting patient on pharmacological treatment. So the answer is, most important criteria for COPD patient in spirometry is FEV1 FVC ratio. And then once you put patient on bronchodilator therapy, inhaled medication therapy, then you just need to track FEV1 at regular intervals.
Yes. So another question is there any marker which can predict the exacerbation of the asthma and COPD a few days before they will have a marker?
Sir, unfortunately, they are still in a research setting, like industry, like IL-6. And there are some sputum markers too. But there is no real recommendation and scientific evidence where I can tell that you use this marker and you can predict that the patient will develop COPD. However, there are different COPD phenotypes. It's a very good question, I must say. Well, as we learn in this PowerPoint presentation about the groups of the COPD patients, as directed to us by the GOLD. In each group, there are certain phenotypes. If the patient is in group B or group C, group D or group A, but the patient is having frequent exacerbations, then it is frequent exacerbated type. So even these patients who are having history of frequent exacerbations, they're in group A or group C, you need to be ultra cautious that this patient might have certain hyper-responsiveness. And in this patient, there can be another element of airway inflammation, which has to be corrected with addition of inhaled corticosteroids. So frequent exacerbated type, they are usually types which are not covered with only bronchodilator therapy, where you might need to add inhaled corticosteroids too. But as of now, there are no scientifically studied biomarkers to conclude that there is that the patient will develop COPD exacerbation in other 5 days, 7 days, or 1 week like that.
Is there any important echocardiogram finding and their utility in the patient with COPD?
Yes, a very important echocardiography finding is development of pulmonary hypertension. Previously, it was told as core pulmonary. How we define pulmonary hypertension or corpulmonale? Corpulmonale is basically development of right ventricular dilatation or dysfunction on echocardiography. And this is very important finding because usually this happens in advanced COPD. When in echocardiography, patient develops RA, RV dilatation, increase in right ventricular systolic pressure. Well, in transthoracic echocardiography, the cutoff value is remaining around 28 to 30 millimeters of mercury. Once they have more than that, it means the lungs are so weak, then that there is development of now corpulmonale. Usually, this is one of the criteria to prescribe home oxygen therapy. So the patients who have developed corpulmonale, pulmonary hypertension, and the symptoms also, they might be candidate for home oxygen therapy. And that is what important change in the medications one should seek for.
Is there any vaccine available for the patient with COPD?
So we give vaccination to prevent exacerbations. As we have learned, that the treatment of stable COPD depends on two pillars: reduction in the symptoms, reduction in the risk. So as a matter of reduction in the risk, non-pharmacological management of COPD comprises vaccination of the patient. Vaccination with influenza, vaccination with the pneumococcal antigen is essential. So in all the COPD patients. But you have to understand that it will not prevent COPD to move forward. It will definitely prevent exacerbation in few selected cases. Second important thing is when you are giving this vaccination. Flu season starts from September to March. So it is very important that you vaccinate your patients early in the season, like in beginning of September. Now it's almost October, first week it's getting over. So many of my patients have already been vaccinated in the September only. So if you vaccinate the patient in beginning of the flu season, you can prevent the exacerbations, but we cannot vaccinate the people, vaccinate the patients to prevent COPD.
The last question is, which factor will decrease the mortality rate in COPD?
Sir, risk factors?
Which factor will decrease mortality rate in COPD?
So, which risk factor will decrease the mortality rate? Okay. In my opinion, this risk factors assessment is very essential part to reduce the exacerbations. Mortality is connected to exacerbations. Exacerbations are connected to overall symptom control. Once we take control of the respiratory symptoms, we eliminate the risk factors which has caused COPD, we reduce exacerbation, we reduce mortality. Okay. So which is the most important intervention, or which is the most important risk factor? If it is eliminated, then the patient will not have exacerbation, and ultimately we can reduce the mortality, is smoking cessation. If the patient continues to smoke, if the patient continues to pursue the same occupational activity, if the patient continues to have biomass fuel exposure, if the patient still resides in the same habitat with the poor air quality index, then the chances of exacerbations are high and chances of mortality are high. So if we can intervene, particularly the smoking cessation, if the patient can quit smoking, if with our help, the patient quits the smoking, which can reduce the risk of exacerbation, and ultimately it will reduce risk of mortality. I think I made it pretty clear.
Yes, sir. So we conclude the question answer session here. And thank you, Dr. Jay Kumar Mehta, for very informative and cover all the aspects of COPD and how to approach the patient of COPD.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for the invitation. Thank you so much.
And thanks to Cipla Respiratory Division for organizing this webinar. And lastly, thanks to all the viewers. Good night to all. Jai Hind. Thank you.
Yes, what are we going to do?